Hey, welcome back. We are talking about big tech censorship. Does it need to happen? Do crazy outlandish voices need to be censored if they're spreading disinformation or misinformation or fake news? It's a huge topic, and I'm here talking to Rhett Long, longtime publisher in Utah, about censorship. What's your take on it? Do you think we need to be censoring people? Their big tech should be censoring people?
No, they have rights. That, you know, our civil rights were designed to protect us from many things. And unfortunately, people can, in today's world, can basically post some things without having proof. And they do every day. So, I mean, some of the, you know, the biggest bloggers have 3-4 million followers a day, and they're giving their opinion. Mm-hmm. They're basically living on opinion, and
you can make a living
cashing a check,
coming out with outlandish opinions and
spreading
them out.
So when I got involved in this, I was actually a spokesperson for Gannett newspapers. You've got Google, you've got Yahoo, you've got pretty much all of our digital platforms that will take content that's written by a newspaper, and they won't give you credit for it. They just scrape it and put it out there. So when Google and Yahoo and your big search engines see that there is content out there that is drawing attention, like one of these stories, they grab it. They want it. They want to get those eyeballs in. So there's another type of censoring that newspapers like to have that, hey, I created that. I don't want anybody taking that. If you're going to at least give me credit for it, you know, tell them that we produced it. So that's one side of the story. The other side on the true censoring of it is, you know, I don't know how it would ever be at this point. You know, cat's out of the bag. And so, you know, look at what Facebook and Twitter have been going through, trying to figure out how to get their algorithms to eliminate or try and figure out whether or not it's true content or not.
Yeah.
And it's
and on the one hand, you have a guy like Alex Jones,
yes,
who was reporting Sandy Hook didn't happen. Guys, that was all fake.
Yep.
And he went back and he recanted, said he was wrong. Well, but on the other hand, you got the Hunter
flat.
Biden laptop story.
The Earth's flat, too.
Yeah, that too. But then on the other hand, you have the Hunter Biden laptop story. All the major news outlets said it's fake news. Twitter censored it as fake news. Did that impact the presidential election? It probably did in a major way. Could have that swung the victory to Donald Trump? Who knows? But the point is, like, to say that we have to have arbiters of truth, you start to get into Orwellian,
yes,
dystopian,
and that's where I was
worlds
gonna go. Exactly.
And unfortunately, I don't know how we can draw a line, and how anybody, any entity, whether it be big tech or government, can ever define where that line should be drawn and who gets to say what they want and who doesn't.
Well, I think the only responsibility that falls is if I'm the owner of a newspaper, I'm responsible for the content it produces.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that the owners, and it might be shareholders, if I'm going to own stock in Facebook, Meta, should I be worried that I'm making a lot of money because there's a lot of fake information out there, and that's what's driving a lot of this revenue?
Mm-hmm.
You know, visits in, and where do people get their news? I mean, I can't tell you how many people say, oh, I read it on Facebook. It's like, oh,
yeah.
Okay, great. But I think that responsibility, from being a newspaper person, I felt I always had that responsibility. If there was something wrong in there, I'm the one that had to say, sorry, we made a mistake.
Yeah.
And so I think that's the one side that I look at.
And
if you're going to give a venue, mm-hmm, you've got to have some controls.
And that's the one way in which the world when we were just newspapers was so much more simple, because you had editors, you had,
yes,
ultimate people who had to be responsible for the content.
Three sources.
And so I have up on my screen, mm-hmm, if you can, Troy, show this, Troy. It's called Section 230. I really had to research this to fully understand it, because this is what the provision is written in the First Amendment law that grants broad legal protections to websites that host user-generated content. And under Section 230, Mark Zuckerberg could say, you know, when Donald Trump was elected, oh, I didn't help him get elected. They just used my platform. And if it was fake news that got him elected, or, you know, he kind of tweaked the system using Cambridge Analytica, that wasn't us. That was a third-party provider. But they were able to drill down and find those people who were most likely to resonate content that would resonate with voters that could help get more votes.
And carried a voice.
Yeah.
Yep, they carried a voice.
It's a very powerful provision. Now, if we were to wipe away Section 230, there would be no platform that wouldn't be censoring everything that would come on it. And every platform would be responsible for all the content on there. But essentially what happened after the 2006 election was Mark Zuckerberg was guilted into censoring certain voices, as was Twitter. And then you find out from the Twitter files that the CIA was working at Twitter. They were censoring posts and people all the time. And the FBI was working at Twitter. And so now we find ourselves where it's this big brother environment where people, your voices are being monitored all the time. The big tech platforms, maybe not anymore now that Elon Musk has bought Twitter. Suppose they're not censoring. I don't know. But it's just such a strange world we're in where some people, it feels like you can say certain things and get away with it, while other people can't say the same things and get away with it. How do you navigate the world of media these days effectively under that landscape?
Well, like I said, you really have to find the sources that develop some content that actually has some integrity behind it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't waste your time on the headlines. Get away from headline reading, because all that does is suck you into the next story. And really try and find some content providers that you believe in. I believe in Wall Street Journal.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yeah, same here.
NPR. I like mm-hmm. NPR. I love the BBC because they make such good fun of us. You know, they really do in a fun way. You know, it's like, oh, guess what?
Yeah.
You know, Trump's only got 91 charges, but he's still running for president. You know, it's mm-hmm. you know, it's one of those things where look for your content and know that you can have some faith in it.
Yeah. Yeah, it's one of those things where I have trusted sources that are more independent that I tend to believe, and then I'll trust them, but then sometimes they're wrong. Like this story that's come out about Tim Ballard.
Yeah.
I thought that Vice News was not doing good journalism. They were basically reporting a bunch of BS that wasn't true. But then it comes out that the church says, no, Tim Ballard, we are distancing ourselves from him. He was using Elder Ballard's name in an inappropriate manner. He was faking people to get more money. And now I believe he was probably a con man the whole time. And it's crazy how I believe that mm-hmm. narrative of the more right-leaning news outlets and independent journalists until it's just come out that maybe he's just a con man.
Yeah.
And it's really hard to navigate, and I don't know what the answer is, but I think that, like you said, you've got to be aware that some people, some outlets have editors with journalistic standards and other outlets do not. And just because they have a connection with Sinclair Broadcasting or Nexstar Media.
Exactly.
Doesn't mean that they're all legit and doing the best job ever.
Nope. And, you know, very seldom do you see a television station come back and say, oh, by the way, we were incorrect on that reporting.
No, you don't see anything in that string of Levitt reports that they ever said they did anything wrong.
Nope.
Yeah.
Or where the content came from.
Nah. Yeah,
that's, they didn't do any investigating.
They didn't investigate it at all. Mm-hmm. It was just all based on that one guy who was.
This is what the sheriff said. This is what we've got. This information, and where did they get it?
So Dateline is investigating the disinformation specialist who fed that news to...
Well, they've got him. You know, they caught him. They've got him in prison. They know the story. So this next one will be very interesting to see how deep this is, because it looks like he may have done this to other people.
Wow. And he uses the lack of journalistic integrity to his advantage to get on a bigger platform
because
of a false story.
You know, if I'm covering a story in newspaper, a lot of time my contacts are local. Mm-hmm. But when you're doing something like this, they're attacking a local person, but it's out there. You know, it's mm-hmm. coming from out there. Well, I don't have anybody trained to go out there and see what content's real.
Yeah.
And so here you got this dark side that's pumping this information into sheriff's department, all these different things, and it looks legit, man. It looks like, you know, it's got names.
It would be
faces
so interesting to find out what his motive was and who was paying him.
Oh, he just wanted to bring him down. He wanted to hurt Levitt. That's what it looks like. Really? That's my take.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess we'll continue to find out what the truth is. But yeah, it's not an easy world to figure that out anymore.
But these are three very interesting stories that we talked about today.
Yeah. Yeah, well, thanks so much for coming on, Rhett. Really
Anytime.
Appreciate it.
Enjoyed it.
Yeah, and I just got to give a plug to our current documentary film that's premiering at Broovies November 2nd. It's The Voices of the Homeless. We've been working on this for 2 years now. It's our first ever documentary film premiere. Tickets are on sale now. They are actually moving quite fast. So while supplies last, you can come to the film premiere. We'll have a panel of guests talking about the homeless situation, like why it's spiraled out of control, and it's really, as I describe, a dumpster fire we're throwing more money into. Downtown Salt Lake City, anybody who lives down there can see with their own eyes it's getting only worse and worse, and how and why that is happening. We've been investigating that for 2 years, so we hope you'll pick up a ticket and join us for the conversation. And please like, subscribe, share this video if you like this content. And we will see you next time. Thanks for watching.